Moving on. Our main story tonight concerns Asian Americans, a group that currently makes up around 7% of the US population and is actually the fastest growing racial group. And yet despite that, Asian Americans can sometimes be oddly overlooked. A recent survey asked respondents to simply name a well-known Asian American, and the results were not good.
42% of people said that they don't know one. The next most popular answers were Jackie Chan, who's from Hong Kong, and Bruce Lee, who died in 1973.
Oh, come on. No disrespect to Jackie Chan and Bruce Lee there, but that is embarrassing even before you consider the poll was conducted while Kamala Harris, who's Asian American, was vice president. How do you fuck up a question that easy? It'd be like asking Americans to name a well-known Joe and getting back, what's Joe? John Krasinski and Joe Millionaire. It is pretty clear many in this country don't seem to know much about the histories or experiences of Asian Americans. And to the extent that experience has been discussed in recent years, it's often been in a tragic context, such as killings or mass shootings or racism around the coronavirus triggering verbal and physical attacks in the street, as well as the kind of idiocy that forced local news to have to produce pieces like, no, you can't get coronavirus by eating Chinese food. Because of course you fucking can't. You're about as likely to get coronavirus from eating Chinese food as you are to get chicken pox from eating KFC. That's not gonna happen, and it's alarming anyone thought it might. And all of this has highlighted the need for us to have a long overdue, better informed conversation about the way this country regards Asian Americans. And before we start, I fully recognize the history of white people on TV generalizing confidently about this subject isn't great, sometimes making statements that are offensive even when they think they're being complimentary, like this idea that has come up constantly.
They've worked their way past column A's and column B's, past no starch please, to become our nation's model minority. Listen to the numbers. Median family income, higher for Asians than for whites.
Once again, super-achieving Asian American students are becoming a phenomenon.
They are overachievers, driven to excel by tradition.
The academic achievement of Asian American students are so notable that in some colleges, students warn each other that if they end up in a class with a lot of Oriental faces, get out. The grading curve, they say, will go out of sight.
Wow. That is jarring to hear, especially when delivered with such a weird combination of amused self-satisfaction and totally inappropriate sourcing. I was eavesdropping on some teens last week and I heard one of them say, never share a cab with a black person. Just thought I'd pass that along. This has been, for some reason, the news. But that idea that Asian Americans are a model minority has been as persistent as it is problematic. So tonight, we thought we'd try and unpack both parts of this sentence. And let's start with the first half. Asian Americans. We're actually going to spend most of our time on this term because it's having to do a lot of work. It encompasses a vast group who can trace their heritage back to more than 20 countries covering a huge amount of the world's landmass, from Mongolia to Indonesia to Pakistan to Japan. And even some who fall under the term Asian American or the broader AAPI, which includes Pacific Islanders, feel that it may not fit them or that the broadness of the category means their experiences get erased.
People associate Asian with East Asian.
Filipinos aren't so much dismissed, they're just overlooked just because they're not as popular within at least the American culture.
Sometimes I will identify as Asian, but then other Indian people don't identify as Asian.
Why are you considered Asian? You're in the Pacific Islander. Wouldn't you be considered more Hawaiian? And I'm like, not really.
Yeah. The term Asian American applies to a ridiculously large and diverse group of people. And there is clearly not going to be enough time to discuss everyone who supposedly fits under that umbrella in this piece, even though I do intend to talk very fast. So apologies in advance to all 127 Maldivian Americans. I promise I will make it up to my one Maldivian American fan in the future. I am serious, Kareem. Stay with me. Trust me on this. You will be seen. But the fact the term Asian American is so incredibly broad isn't an accident. It was kind of the point from the start because it was first coined in the late 1960s by Asian American student activists in California who went on strike alongside Black, Hispanic, and Native American students to demand an ethnic studies curriculum.
In those days, the term Asian American didn't exist. We were all Orientals. 1968, that was the first time that I heard the term Asian Americans.
Asian American encompasses everybody. I thought, wow, that's something. People are finally starting to realize that we wear our race on our face.
It's true. Under a system of white supremacy, we do tend to wear our race on our face. My face, for example, is currently wearing downmarket vintage colonial casual. I'd change it into something a little less imperial if I could, but I can't, so instead, I wear these glasses. For those activists, the term Asian American was an attempt to unite a massively diffuse community in solidarity, thus increasing their power and, crucially, forcing their universities to devote resources to making sure the histories of all their communities were actually taught. It was a political term, a radical redefinition at the time, but it's since become a common shorthand that can unfortunately end up being used in a way that is far too reductive and superficial, to the point where an old government PSA felt the need to make a pretty obvious statement.
People always ask me how I like America. My great-grandfather was born here. Like most Americans, we've been American for a long time. Some of us follow Asian tradition. My family is apple pie American. Mini bikes, football, rock guitar. All Asian Americans are no more alike than any other kind of American. We don't all look alike, do we? Well, do we?
The fuck? Government money paid for that? Even this kid has a smirk that says, fucking white people. Although I will admit, the writer of that PSA defining apple pie American as mini bikes, football, rock guitar is magnificent. It should be the oath of citizenship. You put your hand over your heart, say mini bikes, football, rock guitar, and then you never ride a regular sized bike again. Why? Because you are an American now. And obviously, recognizing the diversity of Asian Americans is about much more than simply recognizing those three children have three different faces. Because one of the main dangers of treating Asian Americans as a single entity is that it obscures the reality of what is happening for the different subgroups inside it. For example, about 10% of Asian Americans live in poverty, which is actually lower than the overall US poverty rate. But when you disaggregate the data, when you break it down by subgroup, you start to see a much more complicated situation, with Mongolian and Burmese Americans having a poverty rate of 25%, more than twice the national average. And when it comes to education, while around 75% of Indian Americans have a bachelor's degree, well above the national average, for Bhutanese Americans, that figure is just 15%, which is well below it. The point is, disaggregating the data can reveal big disparities that you couldn't see previously. Looking at averages for Asian Americans as a whole is like looking at the average income of the Hemsworth brothers. It's very misleading when we all know some Hems are worth a lot more than other Hems are worth. And look, using the term Asian Americans to represent a political coalition made sense, and still does to some extent. But a coalition is not a monolith. And to start to understand some of the present day differences here, it really helps to understand the differences in when and how people came to this country. And you can break down those experiences into a few broad categories, starting with those who arrived earlier in the 19th century and the first half of the 20th. Asian immigration in that time was essentially a cycle of economic exploitation followed by a violent and restrictive backlash. This began with Chinese immigrants who were recruited to work on the railroads in the 1860s. They faced virulent racism from the beginning, both from their bosses who saw their lives as disposable, and from whites, many of whom saw them as unfair competition for jobs. At the time, this senator from California described Chinese immigrants as automatic engines of flesh and blood, making them sound like some kind of railroad lane terminators, and demanded that the federal government secure the American Anglo-Saxon civilization without contamination or adulteration. And in 1882, with the Chinese Exclusion Act, he got his wish.
The Chinese exclusion law is one of the first really comprehensively restrictive laws. And it's also the first and only time in the entire history of the United States that a group is singled out by name, Chinese, by name, as being undesirable. So this is truly a remarkable moment.
Yep. The poster said, hip hurrah to the Chinese Exclusion Act. And if you look at the whole thing, it says in the middle, hip hurrah, the white man is on top, which is a bit redundant. If you've said hip hurrah twice, you really don't need to say the white man is on top. It's like saying Blue Lives Matter or Welcome to Carrie Bradshaw's Bedroom. The white man on top part is very much implied. And America committed to that exclusion policy. Here is something you might not know. There were actually 6 Chinese men who survived the sinking of the Titanic, but upon reaching US shores, were not permitted to enter the United States to recover. Instead, they were forced onto another boat and sent away the very next day. Which isn't just racist, it's insensitive. Did it really have to be another boat? They had just been on the best boat and it fucking sucked. Could you not put them on a Zeppelin or something? At the very least, let's try and mix up the doomed turn of the century transportation methods here. And the experience of Chinese immigrants, unfortunately, set the template for the different groups that followed, because waves of Japanese, Korean, South Asian, and Filipino immigrants later came over as agricultural workers, with those in charge often pitting the groups against each other with unequal wages and treatment. Each group that came faced the common experience of racial hostility, violence, and laws denying them the possibility of becoming citizens or owning land. Here is a poster targeting Chinese people. Here is a sign targeting Japanese people. And here is one targeting Filipinos. It's just like the Statue of Liberty says, give me your tired, your poor, your huddled masses, but not over there, not there either, definitely not in Maine. You know what? You guys just figure it out. Don't worry. The signs will make it really obvious. And no matter how long Asian Americans or their families had been in this country, they were, as now, treated as perpetual foreigners whose loyalties were in question, with the most famous example of this being the World War II internment camps where 120,000 Japanese Americans who'd been rounded up en masse were imprisoned. And to add insult to injury, when they were finally allowed to leave, the US government had the gall to try and give it a positive spin.
If you don't have money enough to get to your new location, the government, through WRA, will make a grant of enough money to get you there, and a little extra until the paychecks start coming in. This money does not have to be repaid. It's a helping hand from Uncle Sam. It's a big moment when you start to pack for your trip outside. It's an even bigger moment when you walk through the gate for the last time and present your pass to the guard for the last time and take a look at the barbed wire fence for the last time.
And as you look at that barbed wire, you can think, fuck you, America, for the last time. Go ahead, we're cool with it. You can even say it out loud if you want to. We'll pretend we didn't hear you and then we'll be even. In fact, you know what, let's shake on that. You can say, fuck you, America, one time and then we'll be cool. But around the middle of the last century, attitudes began to shift as the US, locked in a Cold War, came to see exclusion laws and racial quotas as bad for its global image. So, laws like the Chinese Exclusion Act went away to eventually be replaced by the 1965 Immigration Act. And this is the next broad category of Asian American immigrants, those who came post-1965 as a result of that act. Because in contrast to the previous migrants who were generally relegated to low-wage manual labor, a key thing that this law did was prioritize educated and highly skilled workers like doctors and engineers, and it also tried to address specific labor needs, like when a nursing shortage resulted in overseas ads like these.
Labor recruiters and travel agencies started targeting Filipino nurses with ads that promised them bright futures in America.
One particular ad featured a basket that was decorated with the Philippine flag. It's addressing the Filipino nurse saying, "Dear nurse, if you're not happy where you are right now, contact us. And we can't promise you happiness, but we can help you chase it all over the place."
I've got to say, that is a refreshingly honest slogan. You might not catch happiness, but you can chase it. And it did seem to work, as nurses are one of this country's top imports from the Philippines, followed closely by, of course, Jollibee, the world's greatest fast food mascot. Because believe me, unlike American labor recruiters in the 60s, Jollibee can promise you happiness and deliver it to you in videos like this. Yes, please. I don't know what I love more there, Jollibee tastefully shaking that stinger like it's a bottle of his signature banana ketchup, or the coy flutter of those naughty humanoid eyes. Jollibee can get it. So, very broadly, Asian Americans before 1965 were largely exploited for their labor and legally discriminated against, while after 1965, there were many more who came as skilled workers and who faced fewer formal legal barriers. And then there's the final group here that has less to do with America's labor needs and more to do with its geopolitical interests, those who arrived as refugees. Because between 1975 and 2010, we took in over 1 million refugees from Vietnam, Laos, and Cambodia, which wasn't so much generous as it was a direct result of people seeking refuge from wars that America waged in the region. Basically, we bombed the shit out of their countries to thwart the spread of communism, sometimes in secret wars to fulfill Henry Kissinger's napalm kink. And then, once we took those refugees in, we didn't really do much to set them up for success.
When it comes to refugees, we hold a lot of trauma, a lot of PTSD, a lot of mental illness from the war and the genocide.
We have in the U.S., with respect to our refugee policy, this doctrine of work first, or work immediately. It doesn't matter if you just came from a war zone and haven't healed from the mental and physical traumas of war. We want you to get a low-wage job immediately.
And that is really the full spectrum of the American experience, isn't it? To go from the US not giving a shit about your life abroad to not giving a shit about your life here. Good luck. And by the way, if you think you hear bombs again, try not to freak out. It's either a holiday half the country kind of hates or some couple telling their friends what gender their baby is. Welcome to America. The point is, different groups of Asian Americans have had vastly divergent migration experiences. And when you understand them more, the variation you see in everything from income to education to health outcomes begins to make sense. And yet, groups that have in some ways so little in common often have been unified, unfortunately, through the common experience of bigotry. As was the case in the early 1980s, when America's fear of an economically ascendant Japan led to a racist fervor at home.
Pretty soon, the finger of blame ended up on Japan. All of this hatred, you could feel it. It was palpable.
Detroiters were invited for 50 cents a smash to take out their anger on Japanese cars.
Wow, that's stupid. I honestly can't think of a single good reason to beat up a car, except maybe if Lightning McQueen owes you money. And to be honest, even then, if you really want to hurt him, you don't beat him with a sledgehammer. You light Mater on fire and you make him watch. That's what you do. Everybody knows that. Where is my fucking money, McQueen? But tragically and unsurprisingly, that type of resentment and blame turned to violence and eventually culminated in the murder of Vincent Chin, a Chinese-American man who was beaten to death by two white men who blamed him for what Japan was doing to the US auto industry. Chin's killers were arrested and convicted, but the judge sentenced them to exactly no prison time, instead giving each of them 3 years probation and less than $4,000 in fines. And he insisted at the time he'd made the right decision.
Judge Charles Kaufman says justice was done. He would not talk to CBS News, but he did tell a Detroit newspaper that the two defendants were longtime hardworking members of the community, adding, "These men are not going to go out and harm somebody else. I just didn't think that putting them in prison would do any good for them or for society."
Oh, it gets worse. That judge also said these weren't the kind of men you send to jail. And it's hard to tell what criteria that judge used to decide what kind of men these two murderers were. Was it the color of the skin on their faces, the color of the skin on their hands, or just judicial instinct, a gut feeling that these two men were, in fact, white? That's the thing about the criminal justice system. At the end of the day, it's more race art than race science. But the enduring legacy of the Vincent Chin case was that it managed to bring Asian Americans of all ethnicities together to call for justice. And out of that sprang a new chapter of Asian American activism and political identity. And that is just the most famous example of a rich history of Asian American activism, which has often worked across racial lines, from the student strike that we mentioned earlier, to Filipino labor leaders working with Cesar Chavez to organize a grape boycott, to Yuri Kochiyama's friendship with Malcolm X, and her advocacy for marginalized people of all backgrounds. And yet, a prevailing narrative most people hear regarding Asian Americans is one of conflicts between them and other communities of color, like during the 1992 LA uprising. And look, it's not that those tensions aren't very real, but it's not the whole picture either. And it's also a narrative that fits into a much larger pattern in which white America has actively pitted Asian Americans against other communities. And that brings us to the second half of this sentence and the model minority myth. The idea of the model minority emerged over half a century ago, in part because some Asian Americans were strategically typecasting themselves in a bid to enhance their demands for racial equality, and they did so by promoting their communities as upstanding and hardworking. and as immigration law began selecting for skilled and educated Asian immigrants, the credentials of those new arrivals seemed to conform to the stereotype, which then took on a life of its own, especially in the civil rights era, as whites, unnerved by Black Americans' radical challenges to the system, held up Japanese and Chinese Americans and their success as evidence that they claimed disproved systemic racism. Very basically, America prioritized wealthy, more educated Asian immigrants, then turned to Black people who'd been subjugated for centuries and said, see, they're educated and successful, why aren't you? And using Asian American success to downplay American racism is a trend that very much continues to this day.
If America were such a hate-filled, discriminatory, racist society filled with animus against Asian Americans, how do you explain the remarkable success of Asian Americans in our country?
Their mindset is to just work really hard. It's not to protest things and not to shut things down. It's just to work really hard.
Oh, yeah, they're in the library.
The Asians, the whole reason why they kick ass is because they don't spend any time on petty bullshit.
The Asians are concerned about hate crimes, but they're very upwardly mobile, very success-oriented, very business-oriented. They're model citizens in many cases, in my view. Probably the most admirable ethnic group we have.
Wow. Congratulations, Asian Americans. Dick Morris thinks you're the most admirable ethnic group we have. That's so sweet of him to say. If you want to write Dick a thank you note, just address the envelope to shove this right up Dick Morris's arse, New York, New York, whatever zip code Dick Morris's asshole is in. A central premise of the modern minority myth is that the key to overcoming American racism is simply strong values and hard work, with the implication being that groups that haven't succeeded simply haven't tried hard enough. And putting aside how offensive that is, the truth is, whether or not you're successful, living a life defined by a racist fantasy just isn't good for you.
Striving to maintain the idea of a model minority has really severed my self-esteem. It really makes me feel that I'm nothing more than someone who could get good grades, someone who was supposed to be perfect and be mum about everything.
Right. Trying to be perfect your whole life is going to be too much to bear. That is why I made a promise when I started this show that I'd always get one fact in every story completely wrong. Is that responsible? Absolutely not, but it is what keeps me looking young. And the model minority myth is especially galling for some members of groups like those whose families came as refugees, whose lived experience doesn't remotely match the stereotype. The truth is, that kind of pressure can do real damage. Suicide is the leading cause of death for Asian Americans between the ages of 15 and 24. And yet, apparently, only 8% of Asian Americans sought help for their mental health, which is less than half the rate of the general population. And that is not just a result of cultural stigmas around mental health. It's also what happens when you're consistently told to quietly and happily accept discrimination because your version is the nice racism. But there is no nice racism. There is no silver lining to it, and there is no working your way out of it. You are still perpetually treated as a foreigner, still asked where you're really from, and Asian Americans always seem to be just one geopolitical crisis away from becoming the targets of violence yet again. Whether it's those internment camps for Japanese Americans, or the spate of attacks on South Asians after 9/11, or all of the recent racial violence during the pandemic. So the model minority myth is both a tool of white supremacy and a trap. And as with so many things in this story, with a community this diverse, there are going to be different perspectives on how to handle it. Andrew Yang has annoyed some by leaning into it with self-deprecating jokes and his fucking math hat. And he also angered many when he responded to the Trump administration's China virus rhetoric by writing an op-ed in which he claimed, "We Asian Americans need to embrace and show our Americanness in ways we never have before by, among other things, wearing red, white, and blue." That argument prompted a backlash, with Eddie Wong tweeting, "Fuck out of here with this America drag, you bumbling pineapple bun." And I do get that, because it's pretty insulting to suggest two centuries of racism could be defeated by serving Uncle Sam realness. So all of that is, very simplistically, too broadly, and probably too quickly, an abridged version of how we all got to where we are right now. So, where do we go from here? Well, what is clear is we have to find a way to have smarter, more nuanced conversations about the reality of the Asian American experience. And we cannot do that without access to high quality, disaggregated data that can help better fit public policy to the actual needs of individual communities. But that is not all, because Asian Americans have been warning for decades about all of this. Just watch a man tell a reporter, 5 years before I was even born, what I've been trying to tell you tonight, during yet another of those old model minority profiles.
But I suggested that compared to the black and the Chicano, the Japanese American has it made. He can get a job, a place to live.
It's a situation where I think the question is not material making in terms of economics, but a question basically of human dignity. You know what I mean in terms of human dignity? Like, for example, we've been set in a certain category, and many people argue, man, you got a good stereotype. You got a stereotype that gets you apartments where you don't have to pay a cleaning deposit because you're so goddamn clean. That's our stereotype. But it's an infringement. It's a violation of our human dignity because they don't view us as individuals, as human beings. We fit into a certain category. We fit into a certain box. That's how they view us.
He's right. It's a category. It's a box. But the thing is, you don't learn anything from it unless you bother to look inside. Because obviously, no group, community, or indeed individual is just one thing. And when you reduce the Asian American experience to that of a model minority, you are omitting a history that includes exploitation and exclusion, but also includes activism, some infighting, challenges with issues like immigration, education, and access to social services that continue to this day, and an array of interests and achievements that go far beyond these two guys to be as vast and diverse as America itself. By the way, can you see who's in there? I told you, Kareem! I told you I got your back! I see you, Kareem! And look, I know this story has barely skimmed the surface of this subject, but I hope that it's at least introduced some of you to a bit of the history involved here, as well as what I think we can all agree is the world's most fuckable bee. That's our show. Thank you so much for watching. We'll see you next week. Good night.